Harper Audio presents Nathalia Buttface and the Most Epically Embarrassing Trip Ever by Nigel Smith. Read by Clare Corbett. Chapter 1.
I'm not going on holiday to France, Dad, said Nathalia Bumole crossly. It's rubbish.
The most embarrassing dad in the world paused. He hadn't expected this reaction. In fact, he had come home from the pub with his great French holiday idea, feeling really pleased with himself. Dad liked France. He liked the weather and the food and the wine and talking to local people.
You wear stupid shorts, your bald spot goes pink and peely, you drink red wine every day and get silly and even more embarrassing than usual, and your teeth look like a vampire's,
Nat went on, not pausing for breath.
And the very worst thing is, you talk in a funny accent.
It's called speaking French.
It is not, Dad. It's called speaking in a silly voice. You don't even bother to change the words. You are literally supposed to change the words to actual French ones. I know that, and I'm 11. But I didn't know it in my primary school, did I? In my first French lesson.
Dad put the kettle on. He knew what was coming. He'd heard this story about Nat's first French lesson a lot. He looked around the kitchen for support from Mum, but she was in the living room. She was pretending to do emails, but she was really playing a game on her phone and having a quiet giggle at Dad being in trouble again.
"'Cause of you, when Madame Harrison asked us who could speak any French, I put my hand up.
"'Biscuit,' said Dad, still trying to avoid the story. "'There might be one left as your Nan's not been here for a couple of days.'
But Nat wasn't going to let him escape. She was an angry blur of stick arms and legs and flying blonde hair. Dad was already regretting getting her out of bed to tell her about the great French holiday idea. Nat advanced on her father.
I put my hand up and said, yes, I know French. And Madame Harrison said, wonderful. Come up and tell the class what you had for breakfast in French.
No custard creams,
said Dad, popping the lid of the biscuit tin back on.
I could do you a cheese toasty, though.
But Nat was too busy remembering that horribly embarrassing lesson.
Hello, my little classmates, Nat had said confidently. For breakfast, I add a slice of toast.
She waited for applause.
Very amusing, said Madame Harrison coldly. She didn't look amused.
Nat's classmates giggled.
There is nothing that is funny about a slice of toast.
Nat continued, still speaking what she now called Dad French.
Do it properly or sit down, snapped
Madame Harrison, marking Nat out for special attention that year. Nat pressed on. Perhaps her accent wasn't big enough. She tried Dad French again.
I add this slice of toast and I add a little bit of butter which spreads with a knuff.
The giggling got louder.
A knuff,
said Madame Harrison.
A knuff? What are you talking about, girl?
Like a knuff and fork,
said Nat. By now, the class was in uproar.
Class clown, are you? Said Madame Harrison. Detention!
Dad was always embarrassing her. He could even do it when he wasn't there. Of course, it was way worse when he was there, which was why she had tried so very hard to stop him interfering at her new school. Epic fail. It had started on day one. Nat's form teacher, Miss Honey, was an old friend of Dad's.
Arr!
And had encouraged Dad to join in at school events. Double.
Arr!
Dad had very much joined in. He organised a school trip and lost a pupil and a teacher. He put on a quiz night that ended in a riot. And he was DJ at the end-of-term school disco and accidentally projected Nat's naked baby photos 6 metres high in the school hall. But at least the summer holidays were about to start. After tomorrow, her classmates would have 8 weeks to forget about all the disasters Dad had caused, and with a bit of luck, they might even forget her horrible surname too. Even that was Dad's fault, not just because it was his stupid name, but because he had managed to reveal it live on air on the breakfast radio show that everyone at Nat's school listened to. And it didn't matter how many times she explained Bumole was pronounced Bumole. she was still going to be bumhole for the rest of her school life, unless everyone developed a very short memory over the school holidays. Even her best friend, Darius Bagley, called her Buttface. Dad was talking again now, doing his gentle voice that drove her nuts.
Yes, yes, yes. But let me tell you about my great French holiday idea. It's just brilliant. And the best of it is, it's free.
Dad liked free. Dad liked free a bit too much, if you asked Nat. Mum said that in life, you get what you pay for. Which is why when Mum went food shopping, they got pies with super fluffy crusts full of chunks of tender chicken and veg enfolded in a lovely tasty sauce, perhaps with some rustic hand-cut golden chips. When Dad went food shopping, they got a brown pie in a tin with a big yellow sticker on it saying, "Final reduction. Eat today if you know what's good for you. May cause swelling and rash if rubbed on skin." Mum walked into the kitchen, not smiling anymore. Nat started smiling. Mum had heard the word free too, and she didn't like the sound of it either. "What do you mean, Ivor, when you say free?" she purred dangerously.
"I met Posh Barry down the Red Lion tonight," Dad began.
Both Nat and Mum groaned. They didn't like Posh Barry very much. To be fair, Nat didn't like any of Dad's friends very much because they were all idiots. And when Dad was with them, he became more of an idiot too.
"Posh Barry isn't even posh," said Nat. "He's just one of your stupid old friends from school. He sells scrap. He's always got bits of wire in his hair and he smells like a tin can. So I don't know why you all call him Posh Barry."
"His wife's worse," said Mum, joining in. "Even posher Linda used to be a hairdresser in the high street. She met Barry when he asked her to get the bits of scrap out of his hair. He said it would save him money at the hairdresser's if she married him, so she did. Now she doesn't work and spends most of her time back at her old salon getting her own hair done."
But the absolute worst thing about Posh Barry and even posher Linda was their ghastly daughter, Mimsy. Mimsy was the year above Nat at school. She was spoilt rotten. She was also very popular, mainly because she gave people gifts all the time. It was only stuff she didn't want anymore, or already had a dozen of, but it guaranteed she had loads of friends. Worse, she had a stupid blog that everyone at school read, where she posted about ponies and iPhones and sparkly new trainers and lots of other things that Nat had to pretend she didn't want and wasn't massively jealous of. Whenever Nat was forced to hang out with Mimsy, Mimsy would always make fun of Nat's clothes and her rubbish old phone and obs, her embarrassing dad, which Nat really hated because she was the only person who was allowed to do that. Mimsy liked to put embarrassing photos of Nat's dad on her blog, which, let's be frank, were not hard to find, so everyone at school could have another good laugh at Nat.
"There's no way I'm going to spend my summer holidays hanging out with Mim..."
"Wait! You don't have to.
They're not going to be there. Posh Barry has said we can stay in his lovely new house in France this summer
for free. How about that?"
Nat and Mum eyed Dad suspiciously.
"It's a lovely old farmhouse right down in the south, near the sea, with a pool surrounded by woods. And it's ours."
"Honestly?" said Mum cautiously.
"Honest,"
said Dad.
"They said they wouldn't dare come over till we've finished anyway."
A small warning bell went clang in the back of Nat's head. She ignored it, which, she soon realised, was daft.
"In that case, it sounds nice," said Mum warily.
"I suppose I should say well done." "Thought you'd like it," said Dad, giving her a hug.
"Ew," Nat cringed. "Parents hugging." "Why won't they be there?" said Nat.
She knew her dad and his great ideas and had a horrible feeling that there was more to this story than met the eye. Dad suddenly looked a bit shifty. She'd got him.
"Ah, well, there is one tiny little catch," said Dad. "But it's so small, it's hardly worth mentioning."
"Just mention it, Baldy," thought Nat.
"It might need a tiny bit of work."
Chapter 2. It needed more than a tiny bit. After two pints of Goblin's Knob Ale down the pub, Dad had agreed to patch the roof, fix the floorboards, mend the hot water boiler, repaint downstairs, re-wallpaper upstairs, repair the windows, mow the lawn and put in a cat flap. After a couple more pints, he had volunteered to tarmac the drive, plant some trees and get rid of the ghost. Poshbury wasn't absolutely sure there was a ghost, but his wife, even posher Linda, had sensed something the first night they had stayed there and wasn't going to set foot in the place again until it was got rid of. That was a while ago now, and since then the little French farmhouse had been left to rot.
A ghost, Nat told Darius the next day at school. We've got to stay in an old, damp, smelly, falling-down house with a ghost. And ghosts don't exist, so it'll probably be an axe murderer hiding out. A ghost would be the best pet, said Darius,
whose own pet collection consisted of a one-legged frog called Hoppy, a dead slug, and a jar of flies.
I could train it to haunt Miss Honey.
Nat had just moved to the area and so had only been at her new school for the summer term. But Darius Bagley had quickly become her best friend. This was despite him being the naughtiest boy in the school, town, country, world. No one quite knew how this had happened, least of all Nat. But Nat, being fiercely loyal, argued that Darius wasn't so much naughty as just misunderstood. She was also one of the very few people to realise he was both super bright and super funny, though she did have to admit he was also super embarrassing. But still not as bad as Dad. The hot afternoon was dragging on, and Nat shifted uncomfortably at her desk.
It's just this woman, Linda. She's soft in the head. Dad says when she was a little girl, she was scared by a lady with a scarf at Blackpool Pleasure Beach, and since then, she's been very sensitive to reverberations.
Nat frowned as she tried to get the story right.
I think it was a lady with a scarf. It might have been a donkey with a straw hat. I wasn't really listening. Anyway, it doesn't matter. Point is, she's bonkers, and there's probably no ghost.
Nat was being quite loud, but their teacher, Miss Honey, didn't tell them off for chatting because everyone was chatting. It was nearly the end of term, and it was too hot even with all the windows open, and Miss Honey was flicking through the pages of Last Minute Budget Breaks magazine. Rather than getting on with her marking, she was trying to work out how long she could afford to stay in a lovely beach house on a Greek island. On her wages, it was about an hour and a half. She slammed the magazine shut sharply.
I suppose we should get back to our book, sighed Miss Honey.
The class groaned.
Oh, don't be like that, she said. It's a classic.
That made it worse. Nat knew there were two sorts of classics. Old classics and new classics. They were both terrible, especially when the sun was shining outside. Old classics are written by someone who is dead. Women in these books wear bonnets and faint. They are called Mistress Bindweed. Men are rich and rude and have a secret. They are called Captain Stain. Popular words in old classics include periwig, effervescent and rapscallion. New classics are written by intense people about things that really matter, okay? And no one faints. Popular words in new classics include init, aggro, issues, empowered, and minging. No one in the class was keen to get back to Edna O'Dreary's award-winning novel My Life, Your Fault, so a cheer went up when Nat's dreamy friend Penny Posnitch shouted out,
What are you doing in the holidays, miss?
It was the old ask the teacher about themselves tactic. Now that's a classic. Miss Honey was glad to take the bait. She'd had quite enough of Edna O'Dreary too.
I was invited on a cruise with some friends, she said, where I could have watched palm trees and golden beaches slip by as I lazed around the ship's pool.
Miss Honey had a faraway look in her eyes. Then she frowned.
But I can only afford a return ticket on the Mersey ferry.
The class laughed, and Miss Honey muttered something rude under her breath. Nat hadn't been invited on holiday with any friends that summer, or even round to anyone's house. She had a horrible suspicion part of the problem was the creature sitting next to her, picking his nose and eating the crispy bits.
What are you doing this summer? Nat asked Darius. Mutating into a human? I'm going to Norway with my filthy granny, he said, offhand.
Nat was puzzled. She didn't know he had a granny. In fact, she had a theory that Darius was created in a laboratory somewhere. At home time, she found Darius trudging along with her to the school gate.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.